been quite some time since I've sat here and done this. Let's see if I remember how. Hello, Internet. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To. So, it's funny, I actually recorded a take of this very video that you're seeing here last week, and while I was editing, I noticed that, well, there were a couple things. I didn't like how it was going, as far as what I was talking about, flow, all that. And then to make matters worse, there were some audio hiccups. Thank you, technology. So I decided to scrap that video entirely and wait for another day where I had some time to sit down and refilm it. And lo and behold, I have some time, actually, and I'm not rushed to go to work. I have about more than an hour to sit and do this. I don't think it should take me that long to make this video. So let's just jump right into my intro spiel. 99.9% of the albums I talk about on my videos are all official releases. Whether they were released by a major label, an independent label, or released by the artist themselves, they have all been official. But here and there, maybe in at least one or two videos, I have talked about albums that were not officially released by any of those things I mentioned, and they were put out by some person or group of people in an unofficial way. In that regard, those albums are known as bootlegs. A bootleg is basically an unofficial, unlicensed release. In terms of music, there's a bunch of different cases. It could be an album or a recording that was taken from a live set somewhere out there in the world that a person recorded, put on the internet for everybody to hear, and it got a lot of downloads, and maybe even got a physical release. And in that regard, the physical release could be a recording from that said live show, or it could be an album that was only released digitally, and physical copies were manufactured not by the label or the person who released it, but again, by some person or persons that needed or felt the need to put out physical copies, CD, cassettes, vinyl, out to the public so they could hold it in their hands, and assuming they make a profit from those purchases. In some cases, those physical editions may look like the real deal, even though they're not. Now, I don't necessarily want to go into the whole legal ramifications of bootlegs, but let's just say it's gone through quite an interesting history. In the grand scheme of things, I guess bootlegs are illegal, but you can still actually purchase bootlegs in record stores, and in some cases, labels will even put out official bootleg series. And with that, it's usually just bootleg recordings taken from whatever source the label could find and packaged, manufactured in a box set typically, and put out for the public to easily access. So blah 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 blah, bootleg, not real, not a real album, you get the idea. So for this video, I have gone through my collection here and I have picked out all the bootlegs that I have here in my collection, and we're gonna show them off in all their possibly illegal glory right here, right now. So without further ado, let's get started. Let's hope I don't get in trouble for posting this. And to start things off, the first bootleg album I have for you today is Frank Ocean's Blonde. These bitches born lucky. They're looking for a check. Tell them it ain't likely. Now, I know I have talked about this album several times, actually, in miscellaneous videos, which is why I'm talking about it first right now. There is a big, big history behind the release of this album. In the beginning, Frank had signed with the label Def Jam, which was responsible for releasing his album Channel Orange, which is amazing. It got tons and tons of positive reviews, both from critics and fans, and it even went on to get nominated for a Grammy. Shortly after the release of Channel Orange, Frank had announced he was working on a follow-up album, which I believe he had titled Boys Don't Cry. Needless to say, fans were super pumped for it. But, unfortunately, it would be a good 4 or 5 years until it would come out. Each year, Frank kept saying, it's coming, but would never actually deliver on the release. And it just got to a point where people weren't sure whether or not the album was coming out at all. And finally, in 2016, Frank dropped the album online for everybody to be able to listen to and purchase. And since its release, it has grown to have this huge, huge following. So what exactly delayed the album's release? Well, what happened was Frank actually left Def Jam. He felt that he wasn't getting enough creative freedom with his music. The people behind Def Jam were wanting to change some things that he didn't want to change, and thus he just decided, screw it, I'm gonna leave this label and I'm gonna release this album independently. Hence why the album was only dropped digitally. But in the very beginning, there were actually some very, very limited pressings of vinyl and CD copies of the album, but they sold so quickly. And if you manage to find a legit copy, you're likely gonna have to pay a pretty penny for it. On Discogs, there are people selling CD copies of the album for between $130 to $150, and vinyl copies are going for $300 to $400. Which brings me to my bootleg copy. I am a huge, huge, huge fan of this album. I've been listening to this so much. Ever since I moved to San Francisco 2 years ago, this has been an album that I keep going back to. I never get tired of listening to it. Start to finish, it's fantastic. And me being a CD nerd, I really wanted to own a physical copy of it, but I never wanted to drop the $100-something just to have it. So ultimately, I had to just get used to listening to it digitally, but you know, at least I had something to listen to. But one day, I was visiting the last record store in Santa Rosa, and I stumbled across this copy at their shop being sold for only $9.99. I honestly couldn't believe what I was seeing. So I ran up to the clerk and I asked him, is this a legit copy? But he told me that it was a fake, but they kept getting him in the shop because people were buying them because they were stoked to even have a physical copy of it. And I was one of those people. I bought it right then and there. This album is phenomenal. It's one of the best R&B albums ever. It's one of the best albums I've ever listened to. I'm a diehard fan of it. I'm so happy to have a physical copy of this. Even though it's not an official release, I don't care. The fact that I have it in my hands is great. I do for you in the dark. I do for you in the dark. The next album I have for you here, I have an unofficial release of a Wilco album. For those of you who don't know me that well, Wilco is one of my two all-time favorite bands. I have collected every studio album of theirs, miscellaneous compilations. I have the movie that they put out documenting their recording process of Yankee Hotel Foxtrot. I've seen them live. I have a couple t-shirts of them. I have some pins of theirs. I'm just a diehard fan of Wilco. I thought I had owned it all until one day I was visiting a record store called Watts in Novato, California, and I stumbled across this CD. I had never seen or heard of this album, and I was perplexed that there was some kind of Wilco product that I didn't already own. I remember staring at the track list and thinking it was just some kind of compilation with a really cheesy cover here. But what captured my interest was there were songs on here that weren't Wilco songs at all, but instead covers of other songs. Immigrant Song by Led Zeppelin, Color Me Impressed by The Replacements, I Wanna Be Sedated by The Ramones, and Ziggy Stardust by David Bowie. But I held off on buying it right then and there because it was $16 and I wasn't sure if I wanted to pay that for something that might possibly be a compilation. So I decided to go back home and research the album a bit and see what the story was. But weirdly enough, I couldn't find any information about it whatsoever. So about a month later, I caved. I went back to the record store, picked up the CD, and decided to investigate what the hell was on this. As it turns out, this is actually a bootleg live recording of a show taken in San Francisco sometime in the late 90s. The quality of the recordings are not good at all. In fact, they're mixed pretty quietly compared to their other official live album the band has put out. And normally, I'm not a huge fan of live albums, but I definitely got some enjoyment from this. This album captures a piece of the band's history when they were still young, had only put out two albums. They were full of energy and excitement, and in Jeff Tweedy's case, anger. And they were just there to make rock and roll. So thank you, Watts, for having this guy in your store. I can't find it anywhere else, so if I hadn't visited the shop, I probably would never own this. But I do, and I'm happy I do. So the next album I have for you today, or in this case an EP, I have Billie Eilish's Don't Smile At Me. This CD is kind of weird because it's probably the closest thing to an official release that I will be talking about on this list. So to start from the beginning here, Billie Eilish, fantastic, new, up-and-coming artist. She makes great, great pop songs, both dark and brooding and still very catchy. She started out by releasing singles on the internet, and ultimately that captured the attention of Interscope Records, who she signed with. She then recorded songs that would ultimately end up being this EP. And it was then released by Interscope on iTunes and other digital purchase services to be consumed by the public. But Interscope also manufactured some limited CDR copies of the EP for fans to purchase at Billie's concerts. And this particular guy is one of those CDRs. Eventually down the line, the EP did get an official release on the vinyl and cassette format, and it also did get a CD release, but only in Japan for whatever reason. So there isn't necessarily a US official release, but if you want an official release, you're gonna have to import it from Japan. But this CDR copy actually does not belong to me. It belongs to my girlfriend. She is a mega fan of Billie's work, and she was really disappointed when there was not a CD release that she could purchase because she had been listening to it on and on and on for months, and she wanted some copy to own in our collection. So I scoured the internet to find something, and that's how I discovered this CDR copy. And I ended up paying, I don't know, maybe 40 bucks for it. These CDR copies are surprisingly kind of pricey. I looked up how much this was going for on Discogs before recording this video, and it goes for anywhere between $30 to $50, not counting the shipping. But yeah, this is kind of a weird release. I don't know if it's a bootleg because it's not necessarily official, but it isn't official, so is it a bootleg? I don't know. In the case of this video, I'm counting it as a bootleg. It's a CDR, it looks great, it sounds great, and I'm just glad there's a copy of it in our collection, and I'm glad I could have given this to my girlfriend because she was so stoked to own it. And I hate to do this to you. The next album I have for you today, oh, this one is gonna be a gruesome one. So much so that I can't actually show the cover art of it because I don't want this video to get taken down. The album I'm talking about here, this is Mayhem's Dawn of the Black Hearts. I have talked extensively about Mayhem in many, many, many videos of mine. They are probably my favorite black metal band out there. They're the band that got me into black metal in the first place. If you are an avid listener of them, you know that they have quite the bloody and violent history. But if you're new to the band or even the history of black metal in general, boy, do I have a story to tell you. The Norwegian black metal scene started to develop in the very, very late 80s and the early 90s. Amongst the many bands that came around was this band called Mayhem. They developed this cult following for making this really raw, grimy, and brooding sounding music. Not to mention the people in the band were heavily, heavily involved in the black metal scene, and also had a lot of strong opinions. We call those hot takes nowadays. There was a certain time in between the years of 92 and 94 where it was a golden age lineup for Mayhem. In the band featured the guitarist Euronymous and the vocalist Dead. Both of them were mega talented at what they did, and they contributed some of the band's best material ever. Sadly, though, there are not a whole lot of recordings of the both of them in the band, particularly featuring the vocalist Dead. The only recordings that do exist were taken from miscellaneous live shows they had performed, and the quality of the recordings are really, 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 really poor. So what happened? Why are there such limited recordings of them? Well, they're both dead now. This is getting to the CD, I promise. So, the vocalist Dead, even though he was a really talented guy, had a lot of interesting personality traits. A lot of people described him as odd, introverted, sad, and depressed, and he had a lot of interesting quirks that he would do on stage. He would cut his wrists on stage, he would throw pig heads out into the audience to scare them. He was one of the people to use corpse paint on his face to make himself look like he was dead. And to go even further, he would sometimes bury his clothes before performances, only to unbury them when going on stage, so he could make it look like he was buried and was a corpse. He would starve himself to get these wounds on him. He wanted to look like he was actually dead. At the time, the band was living in this house in the forest where they would also use it as a recording space. Dead was left alone in the house for a couple of hours, and when Euronymous returned home, he came in to find Dead's corpse on the ground with a shotgun wound through his head. And though he was shocked by this sight, the first thing Euronymous did was leave the house, go to a convenience store, purchase a disposable camera, go back to the house, rearrange the objects in the scene to put like a knife and the shotgun by Dead's body, and took pictures of it. And one of the photos that he took ended up being the cover of this bootleg album. Again, I'm not going to show you the picture on this video because it's a really, really, really gruesome sight. If you do want to see it, just go search for it on Google Images. It'll be like the first thing you'll find. But fair warning, if you are squeamish to blood and gore, you're not gonna bode well to it. So why the fuck did Euronymous do such a disgusting and awful thing? Well, again, there were a lot of hot takes in the black metal scene. And in Euronymous's mind, he thought that the photo evoked what black metal stood for. It wasn't for posers who thought they liked metal. It was supposed to be dark and gruesome and bloody and, you know, violent. But Dead's suicide caused a massive rift in the black metal community. Some people were absolutely not cool with what Euronymous had done. Others were totally okay with it, and they would go on to burn churches and do whatever he wanted them to do. And that eventually led to Euronymous getting killed by Varg Vikernes, but we don't need to go down that way. Just know that he was killed! Dawn of the Black Hearts features recordings from a concert taken sometime in, I think, 1990. It did eventually get an official release, I think actually last year, with a new cover, thankfully, and even a DVD featuring rare unseen footage of the band performing. But I stumbled across this bootleg at Amoeba probably a couple months ago, and I was honestly shocked that they could show something like this, but I had known about the album and its history, so I bought it anyways. It's definitely not the prettiest thing I have in my collection, but as a collector and as a fan of that lineup of Mayhem, I had to own it. And that concludes the bloody history of Mayhem. I think I need to move on to the next album because I don't know what else to say about this. Let's just put this down here. The final bootleg album I have here on this list does not come in the form of a CD, but instead a cassette. This is Flying Saucer Attacks PA Blues. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Wilco is one of my two all-time favorite bands. Flying Saucer Attack is the other favorite band of all time. I have collected every single thing of the band, both on CD and vinyl. They are criminally underrated. Not a whole lot of people know about them, and if they do, they're only really familiar with the first album. Thankfully, there has been a small renaissance of the band. Labels are reissuing their LPs that were once almost impossible to get. Big thanks to Drag City and VHF for doing that. You're doing God's work. We love you so much for it. But when I thought that I had it all, that's when I discovered this album. Before all the reissues of the albums were coming out, not a whole lot was really known about the band, and you really couldn't find a whole lot of information on the internet. I know, I looked. But I was able to get a bit of a loose list of what was in the band's discography, and that's how I discovered this album. What PA Blues is a four-track compilation of rehearsals and live recordings taken from wherever, picked out by Dave Pierce himself, and compiled and released as a CDR in very, very, very limited quantities. So limited that if you find a copy, again, you're gonna be paying a huge amount of money for it. Right now there's a copy going on Discogs for about $103, which is way, way, way outside my price range. But I'm watching it because if it goes down, I'm gonna grab it. Which brings me to why I have it on cassette. At the time I discovered the existence of this album, there was no way to listen to it at all. And as a huge fan of the band, it killed me that there was an album of theirs that was out there in the world that I didn't have, let alone could even not listen to. So after scouring the internet long enough, I managed to find somebody who had made bootleg copies of the album on cassette and were selling them for, I think it was like $25. Compared to $100, that's a bargain, but they were limited copies because he had only made 100 of them. I have the 54th edition. Can you see that? Yeah, there it is, right there. Now that the band is more recognized, Dave Pierce eventually did release this album on his Bandcamp for only $7, so there's an easy way to listen to it. I got that just so I could easily listen to it, and I have this to kind of satisfy my craving for physical copies. But I still really, really, really want the CD version. At some point in my life, I know I'll get it, whether I end up dropping the $100 to buy it or I find it for a reasonable price. But whenever that time will be, I'll have to just stick with my digital copy and my cassette copy. Okay, internet, that doesn't do it for me. What? I have a bonus album for you that I'm gonna talk about right now.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Olin from the future here, bringing you some more bootleg albums. I know that past Olin said there would be one more bootleg album that was going to be a bonus, but instead I actually have a couple more that I will show you. But I'll make it quick, because this video is already pretty damn long, and I have a lot of work to do if I want to edit it down a bit. So getting right to it, the next bootleg album I have for you here, this literally just got in the mail. I have Lamont Young, or Lamonti Young's The Black album. In the world of drone and experimental music, this guy is a hugely important figure. His whole approach to music was sustained notes, whether that be the use of a voice, a piano, a viola, saxophone, whatever it was. He had these pieces that he would compose that would go on for hours and hours on end. The sad thing is not a lot of his works were ever recorded and released to the public, at least not in any official way. Which brings us to this bootleg. This guy here collects two recordings, only two, onto a CD here, and each recording is, I believe, about 30 minutes apiece. The first one features what sounds like some sort of droning electronic with one or two voices that will harmonize together and just hold onto one note. Meanwhile, the second track is a recording of a bowed gong duet. And as weird as it sounds, it's incredible. Initially, I thought it incorporated the use of electronics that was creating that noise, but doing some further reading and discovering it was gongs made me realize how ahead of the curve this guy was with creating sound. And with that said, I immediately sought out a copy of this. And I actually had to ship this all the way from Russia because bootleg copies of this, I guess, just were never manufactured in the States. I literally just came back from the post office. I unwrapped this from its plastic wrap and sat down to record this right now. So this is brand spanking new. I'm so very excited to have something of Lamont Young's work in my collection. He is a amazing, amazing composer, and I recommend any of you who are a fan of drone music, you should absolutely look into this guy. He is one of the reasons why drone music is a thing today. The last albums I have for you today, I have three here, but they're all by the same people. I have Kraftwerk's first, second, and third album in their discography. Kraftwerk might have been one of the earliest, I guess you could call experimental or weird bands that I ever listened to. And you can thank my dad for that, because when I was a kid, he had a copy of their album, The Mix, which I did just recently get for nostalgic purposes. But while I was at Amoeba looking for The Mix, I happened to stumble across these three albums in their stock. And I was honest to God so surprised to find them, because I knew that these albums were never officially pressed on CD. And I'd known about them for the longest time. I can't remember if I had actively searched for them, but I do remember that when I found out they were only ever pressed on vinyl, I pretty much gave up on trying to find them, because in my mind I thought, well, I don't really want to get the vinyl, I'd rather have it on CD. It doesn't really exist on CD, so what's the point? Let's not even search for it. But the fact that I did find CD copies of them at Amoeba was so very exciting. And what's more exciting is I went on Discogs to go look up and see if there were people selling the bootleg copies of these albums on their site, and they're actually banned. You can't buy them on Discogs at all. I can't speak for whether or not you can buy them on eBay or not. You probably could. I couldn't tell you how much they were, but the fact of the matter is I found them in the wild, and now I have them, and it's awesome. The funny thing about these albums is Kraftwerk has kind of tried to not include them in their main discography, and that's just because they sound nothing like what Kraftwerk is known for making. Kraftwerk is more known for their later stuff like Radioactivity, Autobahn, The Man Machine, all those classic techno albums that went on to really pioneer electronica. These three albums, however, while there are some electronica elements to them, sound more like experimental krautrock albums. And from what I understand, all the recordings spread on these three albums were all improvised in the studio, so that means even more experimentation. And while I do like them all, I think it's this one that's my favorite. And it's hard to pick favorites, because again, they're all really good, but this one in particular is my favorite. It's more music concrete, it's a lot more rock oriented. Again, there's a little bit of electronics in it, but this one to me sounds more like a rock band compared to the other work that they've done. I am so, so thrilled that I can add these to my collection. Thank you, Amoeba, for carrying these. They're fantastic. They honestly have renewed my interest in krautrock, and I've since picked up a couple more krautrock albums that I may or may not talk about in future videos. We'll see. But until then, I will be continuously enjoying the hell out of these for days, months, years to come. These are phenomenal. From me, future Olin. Back to you, past Olin, right now.
Okay, internet, that actually does it for me. Thank you all so much for watching. If you have any bands or albums you want me to check out, particularly in the bootleg department, leave a comment down below, and if I like it, maybe I'll include it in another video. Also, if you like this video, be sure to hit that subscribe button. It'll show me the support, and I'll love your face for it. And if you want more music, you can follow me on Instagram. I post a new album whenever I can, not every day anymore because that's just getting too exhausting. Talk a little bit about it, and it gives you a bit of an insight of what else is in my collection. So again, thank you all so much for watching. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To, signing out. Goodbye.